Hello, you're watching Proactive UK. You're with me, Katie Pilbeam. The price of gold has surged beyond $2,000 an ounce. It's up over 30% so far this year. To discuss this and what it means for the company HANetf, I am joined by the co-CEO just now. We've got Hector McNeil. Hello to you, Hector. How are you doing?
I'm all right, Katie. Yourself?
Excellent. Really well. Thank you very much. Yeah. What a time to be involved with gold. It's quite a surge, isn't it? Do you think that this is here to stay? Has it got more room?
Oh, I think it's got a long way to go. You know, certainly if you look at what's going on in the world, you know, it's almost a perfect scenario for gold. You know, you've got a lot of political uncertainty. You've got the coronavirus. You know, you've got this great insurance asset that people are leaning on, and you've got dollar weakness. So you've got a lot of reasons why gold, I think, is probably got a long way to go yet.
Yeah, all the macroeconomics are playing their part, aren't they? And we've got investors getting towards those safe havens. What does it mean for you, though? Let's talk about ETS. What's happening there? What action have you seen?
Well, I mean, I was part of the venture back in the day, ETF Skews, where we invented gold ETFs. And just as an indicator of that, it's probably more about my age than anything else, but the price of gold was $250 an ounce when we listed the first one in 2003. You know, so being at 2000, you know, is a real landmark event all in all. But I think it's, you know, it's just a sign that gold really does what it does. It's almost like what I call the, you know, the parachute or the crash airbag. You know, it's there to protect you in these sorts of times. Mm-hmm. And I think it's doing that job great because, you know, you look at what's happening with all central banks printing money and all that sort of scenario. And, you know, if you put all the gold in the world has ever been in one place, it's the size of two Olympic swimming pools put together. You know, so it's a very finite supply, you know, and you can't, you know, you can only get so much out of the ground in any one time. So it's a fantastic asset. And what's really great about gold ETFs is that, you know, even until like the mid-70s, it was illegal in the US for retail to own gold. You know, Roosevelt privatized gold in the 30s, you know, and I think when ETFs came along, it really democratized the ability for investors to hold physical gold without actually putting it under their mattress or in their drawers or in their safe at home. You know, you could have a finance instrument that's 100% backed by LBMA good delivery bars that sit in a vault, but you've got an ownership in that. And I think that's really massive for investors. In fact, when we created the world's first gold ETF, we called it the People's Central Bank because it was an ability for, you know, my mother or my sisters or my father to own gold in a really efficient way for the first time. Now at HANetf, you know, earlier this year, end of February, we issued the Royal Mint's first financial product, which was a gold ETF, ticker RMAU. Now, probably what you don't know is the Royal Mint's actually Britain's oldest company. It's been around for 1,100 years. It was set up by Alfred the Great in 886. Isaac Newton was the CEO for nearly 30 years at the Royal Mint. It's lasted the Spanish flu, the Black Death, the bubonic plague, two world wars, civil war, the Norman conquest. You know, it's got a massive, massive provenance, and it got into this game because it makes 6 billion coins a year. It's, you know, it makes sovereigns, Britannias, kilo bars. And actually, having a financial instrument like a gold ETF made a lot of sense because it's got the most secure vault in the world. You know, it's sitting in Wales rather than London, and issuing a product off the back of it is exactly what people need in times like this. Because what most of the gold ETFs in the world have is they hold gold in bank vaults. And if you think about it, people hold gold to hedge financial systemic risk. Mm-hmm. Now, it's a bit of a weird scenario that you would hold gold at a bank to hedge yourself against banks. So having a non-financial company where you can hold your gold is actually really critical, really important. And the Royal Mint's actually 100% owned by Her Majesty's Treasury, so it's not part of the financial system. So we listed that product at the end of February, and we've already got $360 million of assets. It's the fastest growing gold ETF in Europe, you know, and I think it's really resonating, particularly with UK retail, you know, as that sort of go-to safe haven, not just for the gold itself, but actually how it's stored and how it's kept. So it's been fantastic for us, really.
It really has. It really is golden times for you, isn't it, Hector?
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much indeed. That's very good.
Well, exactly. Done. I'm going to keep it. Don't steal it. And thank you very much indeed for that catch up. Hopefully we'll speak to you once again. And who knows, it might be at 2,500. What do you reckon?
Well, I think you're talking more like 3,000. I think it could go as high as that. Yeah, I think you've got a long way to go. Yeah, I think BAM will put a report out, and I sort of concur with that. I think there's a long way to go. And actually, when you consider that inflation in terms of that price inflation, if you look at it compared to the FANG stocks or whatever, it's nothing, you know. So actually seeing a, you know, 50% growth from here, you know, you wouldn't even blink an eyelid if you said that was Facebook or Amazon or whatever. So for gold, which is something real, you know, you can't invent it. Alchemy has been tried for thousands of years, but never succeeded. I'll leave you on this note. I think if you look at every financial system ever created, gold is the only one that's never collapsed. Every other one in the world has defaulted or fallen over or gone by the wayside. But gold is the one that stayed there through the test time, 10,000 plus years. And that says a lot for me.
It's dependable, that's for sure. Just before I let you go, you're saying 3,000, but when?
I think you could see it by year end, actually. I think the friction that in the economy that Corona is going to bring, you know, particularly after things like coming off the furlough, you know, similar schemes in other countries around the world, the unemployment that's going to bring, you know, is going to create a huge amount of uncertainty that's sort of been kicked down the road so far. You know, and I think, you know, there's a good potential that could create a lot of volatility, a lot of insecurity in the economy. And I think you'll see a lot more people sort of hiding and rushing to gold to give themselves that extra protection. So normally you'd see a portfolio sort of 3-7% in gold. You may say that go up to 10-15%. A lot of that might be price improvement, you know, price growth. But I think, you're seeing a lot of volumes going into, you know, physical gold, gold ETFs, you know, gold futures. But I think you'll see more of that as it goes along, because people are going to be seeing, well, where else do you go? You know, where else do you go? You're not going to, money is costing you money to invest in the Swiss franc or the euro or whatever it is. So, you know, that's going to put people into something where they say, well, actually, there's no interest to be earned. Where can I protect my capital? And that's going to be gold. I think you're going to see more of that as time goes on.
Hector, thank you very much indeed. Looking forward to chatting to you next time.
Thank you very much. Have a good day.